It is both an honor and a pleasure for me to introduce Farahnaz Ispahani. She has a career, several careers, both distinguished and brave. Her earliest career was as a journalist in both print and television media. She's worked for Voice of America, MSNBC, ABC News, and CNN, perhaps amongst others. Politically, she opposed the dictator Musharraf when he ruled Pakistan. And in 2007, she returned to Pakistan accompanying Benazir Bhutto. From 2008 to 2012, she was a media advisor to the president of Pakistan and also a very active member of parliament, particularly involved in the Women's Caucus and focused very much on issues of the status of women, human rights generally, and the situation of religious minorities, something we will touch on today. In recent years, she has been a scholar in the United States at the National Endowment for Democracy and the Woodrow Wilson Center, particularly working on women and extremist groups. This year, Oxford University Press has published her book, Purifying the Land of the Pure, A History of Pakistan's Religious Minorities. Apart from this distinguished history, I also know she is a person of delightful irony and wit. And we were mentioning 10 years ago, I had the pleasure of accompanying, amongst others, Farahnaz and her husband, Hussein Akhani, on a boat from Istanbul to the Princess Islands in the Sea of Marmara. And I asked them, when did you meet? And there was a sort of slight confused silence, worried, and I thought, is this the situation where one, usually the male, has sort of actually forgotten? And but this turned out not to be forgetfulness, but it depended on what you meant by meet. When Farah was an active journalist, various people had sought to get her together with Hussein, to go on a date, meet. They thought they would get on well together. But this was very difficult to arrange. And Hussein was not phoning, was not returning phone calls, and was not showing up. And Farahnaz was getting somewhat frustrated with this and went to her mother and said, you know, he just stood me up again, this guy. I can't stand him. And then her mother held up the newspaper, which said, Haqqani kidnapped, ? Kidnap being somewhat of a euphemism in that the kidnappers would be the intelligence services. So this delayed the sort of actual meeting and a real date for a while. So this was the background to the confusion. So Farah is an accomplished scholar, writer, politician, and hangs around in very interesting circles. It's a great delight to introduce her. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Paul. And I'd also like to thank Professor Philpott, Tim Shaw, Nina Shea, so many, Luann Sabatier, so many friends through hard times who have been now with us in better times as well. And I will never forget your love and support. I'm going to talk about Pakistan today, and I'm going to talk about it a little differently than His Excellency, because I come to the work, as Paul just said, as a scholar and an activist, so my view is a little perhaps more pointed. So it's a privilege for me to speak to you today at the launch of In Response to Persecution, which is an important element of the Under Caesar Sword Project. The team that has put together this report deserves not only our commendation for their efforts, but our full support in seeking greater engagement on the issue of religious persecution around the world. The mistreatment or marginalization of ethnic and religious minorities has become a global phenomenon. Demagogues are generating hatred for the other in the United States, Europe, and all over the Middle East. Attacking minorities is, for some, a way to garner support of a strong faction within the majority. Communal majoritarianism serves as a distraction from social and economic problems. In some cases, it is argued that only the creation of a purer society, purer in ethnicity or religious composition of a society, would somehow enable a nation to overcome its problems. The end result, however, is the same everywhere. Violence against minorities is unleashed, causing human suffering. Religious discrimination and persecution is often disguised as measures to, in brackets, protect the beliefs or religion of the majority against slander or hurtful comments. It is a clear violation of the United Nations Declaration on Human Rights, which in Article 18 explicitly says, everyone has the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. This right includes freedom to change his religion or belief, and freedom either alone or in community with others, and in public or private, to manifest his religion or belief in teaching, practice, worship, and observance. Many governments that are part of the United Nations and are signatories to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights have in recent years been progressively limiting the religious freedoms that they committed themselves to under that declaration. It is important to note that Christians are the victims of 80% of all acts of religious discrimination in the world. Efforts to highlight, oppose, and prevent religious discrimination globally are, therefore, efforts that protect and defend the rights of Christians to profess and practice their faith. Standing up for the rights of all religious minorities everywhere is the way forward if Christians in the United States want to help protect Christians in countries where they are under attack. The Egyptian cities of Alexandria and Tanta are still reeling after Islamic State suicide bombers killed 45 people attending Palm Sunday services recently. Last week, a frenzied mob lynched a Muslim student accused of blasphemy at a university in Pakistan's northwestern city of Mardan. You may be asking yourself, what is the connection? Well, thousands of miles apart, one was an act of well-planned terrorism, the other the result of mob violence. But both represented the growing intolerance and in some cases indifference towards religious minorities in majority Muslim countries. The victims of the Palm Sunday massacre in Egypt were Coptic Christians, an ancient sect established by Saint Mark the Apostle thousands of years ago. Easter is their most sacred holiday and their holiest feast. In recent years, Copts have been targeted with considerable frequency in Egypt. In late March, a bomb was defused at the Tanta Church, where 28 people died just last week. In December, 30 churchgoers were killed in Cairo. The former chair of the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom, Katrina Lantos-Sweat, observed not long ago, "We are witnessing levels of persecution of ancient Christian communities of the Middle East at levels that are something that we have not seen, one could almost say, in millennia. it's very disturbing and disheartening. Mistreatment of one religious community is often the starting point of a slippery slope that leads to persecution and violence against others. As a human rights activist, I have been concerned about the treatment of religious minorities in my country, Pakistan. In my book, Purifying the Land of the Pure, I demonstrate how the country's bigots first targeted Hindus and Sikhs soon after the country's creation in 1947, going on to target others, including Christians, over time. Their desire to make Pakistan religiously purer led to a debate about who is a true Muslim, which has led to persecution of non-Sunni sects within Islam as well. When it was partitioned from India 70 years ago, Pakistan had a healthy minority population of 23%. I don't know how many people know that. Almost a quarter of Pakistan's population was non-Muslim. Now, even after legally redefining a denomination, the Ahmadis, originally considered Muslim as non-Muslim, Pakistan's non-Muslim population is down to 3%, from 23 to 3%. Cautionary tale needs to be studied more. Hindus and Sikhs left for India. Many Christians and most Zoroastrians emigrated to Britain, Australia, and North America. But the religious battles within Pakistan are not over even after such a drastic reduction in the non-Muslim population. According to Yusuf again, Pakistan represents one of the worst situations in the world for religious freedom for countries not currently designated by the US government as countries of particular concern. So I'm going to explain a little bit how Pakistan has arrived at where it is now, because it is, as I was saying, a good case study, a model to see how in countries where communities are forcibly pitted against each other, which is what happened in Pakistan, what the end result is. Pakistan's descent into that state has come in several stages, spread over 70 years. It is in many ways a cautionary tale of how ignoring one phase of discrimination against or persecution of minorities can lead to other more dangerous situations. The first phase in Pakistan was Muslimization, representing the large-scale expulsion of Hindus and Sikhs amidst the riots on partition, which were considered retaliation for similar riots against Muslims in some parts of India. This phase lasted from 1947 to 1958 and witnessed a massive decline in the Hindu and Sikh population of Pakistan. Christians, by and large, were not affected during this stage, and the world in general did little to publicly criticize or consider sanctions over the forced demographic change. Having Muslimized Pakistan by reducing its share of non-Muslims, Pakistan's leaders embarked on the second stage of building an Islamic identity for Pakistan. State-sponsored textbooks rejecting pluralism became part of the curricula between 1958 and 1971. There were occasional sectarian and religious riots, and Pakistan institutionalized the otherization of non-Muslims. The third stage in Pakistan's tragic history came in the form of Islamization, which began in 1974 with the declaration of Ahmadis as constitutionally and legally non-Muslim, only country in the world which has done that, and continued in earnest until 1988 with effects that continued to impact the lives of non-Muslims and Muslims alike. During this phase, laws discriminating against minorities or open to abuse of minorities were written and enacted. Islamic courts were established, and measures based on Islamic law gained the sanction of the state. The road was paved for vigilante actions, as anyone was empowered to initiate blasphemy proceedings against another individual, and in many cases also acted on their own to protect what was described as the glory of Islam and the honor of its holy prophet. Since 1988 to the present moment, Pakistan is mired in the fourth stage, one of militant hostility, terrorism, and organized violence against non-Muslims, minority sects within Islam, and even non-practicing or secular Muslims. In this phase, which is where Pakistan is today, militant Islamist groups and organized bands of terrorists have methodically targeted whomever they have deemed a threat to their own extremist interpretation of Islam. Minorities have borne the brunt of this violence. Since 1988, there have been 3,058 incidents of sectarian violence, resulting in 5,484 deaths and more than 10,000 injured. These include terrorist attacks on Shia and Ahmadi mosques, Hindu temples, and Christian churches, as well as on community activities marking religious festivals, in addition to targeted killings of community leaders. Notwithstanding chronic sectarian violence targeting Shia Muslims, Christians, Ahmadi Muslims, and Hindus, Pakistan has not been designated a country of particular concern, even though USERF has recommended that designation under the International Religious Freedom Act every year till 2002. The views of the State Department about the strategic importance of Pakistan consistently takes precedence over concerns relating to mistreatment of its minorities, including Christians. Pakistan's blasphemy laws, coupled with mob violence that follows charges of blasphemy, illustrate how legal regimes designed to appease Islamist extremists promote lawlessness against minorities. Paul Marshall and Nina Shea, in their book Silenced, have described in detail the various legal restrictions on freedom of religion across the world, including Pakistan. If you're interested in this, I would get that book. According to USERF's 2015 report, in civilian courts where the majority of these blasphemy cases are heard, militants can intimidate judges and lawyers, and perpetrators of mob attacks are frequently released on bail. Although the blasphemy laws were imposed under military dictatorship in the 1980s, elected civilians have done little to reform these repressive laws. In 2015, Pakistan's National Assembly, which I was a member of, spent only 15 hours out of 1,000 to discuss rising violence against religious minorities. So that's how important the parliamentarians, elected parliamentarians in Pakistan, think this issue is. USERF observed last year that the current Pakistani government has even decreased the representation of religious minorities in positions of influence, folding the Interfaith Harmony Ministry, created by a previous government, into the Ministry for Religious Affairs, which primarily deals with the annual pilgrimage to Mecca for Hajj. The consequence of lack of attention is that violence against Christians continued, with few concrete actions taken by federal or provincial officials to ensure their protection. After the 2013 mob attack on the Christian neighborhood of Joseph Colony in Lahore, Punjab, the provincial government provided some reparations, but all the attackers were released on bail. The only person serving a prison sentence is a Christian falsely accused of blasphemy, who was sentenced to death. So, firstly, you have this mob attack on this Christian area, and all of the perpetrators are released on bail, and the only person remaining in bail is a Christian who somehow was accused of blasphemy. That's justice for religious minorities in Pakistan. There is none. Other attacks against Christians because of allegations of blasphemy continue. Violence continues to be perpetrated around blasphemy allegations, most recently well, recently in March 2014, a Pakistani Christian was murdered after being acquitted. So now there is a great deal of mob violence and vigilante justice. And in November of 2014, was earlier mentioned by my colleague, His Eminence from Lahore, a mob killed a Christian man and his pregnant wife. I want to take their names because it is very important to give them at least that decency. They were not just two Christians. They were two human beings. A Christian man and his wife, pregnant wife, her name was Shama and his was Shehzad, were accused of blasphemy, killed by a mob, and then burnt to death by throwing them into a brick kiln. The actual reason behind this was a fight with the owner of the brick kiln over salaries. Last week in Lahore, last week in Pakistan, Mashal Khan was the victim of lynching at Pakistan's Mardan University, and he was beaten to death after debate among students on religion. As is common in Pakistan, accusations of blasphemy followed, possibly because the victim had questioned the corrupt practices of university officials. So again, the actual reason was something else. It's just so easy to call blasphemy, and it's a death sentence. It is not uncommon for someone to accuse another of blasphemy to settle scores, seal their property, or simply divert attention from some other issue or dispute. Although this particular victim, Mashal Khan, was from a mainstream Muslim family, many blasphemy cases center on Christians and members of the Ahmadiyya community. They are the two most, I would say, it's hard to say which minority is most persecuted in Pakistan, but I would say the Christians and Ahmadiyya Muslims rank at the top of this. In terms of some numbers, I would say since 1990, at least 65 known people have been murdered in Pakistan over unproven allegations of blasphemy. Unproven. Most members of this illustrious audience will probably know the case of Asia Bibi. She was an illiterate berry picker of the Christian faith who is on death row in Pakistan for blasphemy. Asia Bibi was arrested in 2009 following an angry dispute with fellow women field hands over whether she, a Christian, was too impure to sip from a cup of water she had brought for them. The mother of five denies that she blasphemed and has testified that she was merely professing her Christian faith. At her initial trial, Asia Bibi's inexperienced lawyer failed to cross-examine the two witnesses or object to errors in the proceedings. Asia Bibi was convicted under Pakistan's 1986 blasphemy law and sentenced to death by hanging. Since then, she's been on death row. She's been placed in solitary confinement for her own protection. Because although Pakistan's never carried out the death penalty for blasphemy, many defendants in similar cases have been murdered by cellmates and guards. The moment the word blasphemy is used, as I said earlier, it's a death sentence. Asia Bibi's was the first capital blasphemy conviction against a woman to be affirmed by a Pakistani appellate court. Her final appeal before the Supreme Court continues to be delayed on one pretext or the other. Anyone with influence here or any ability, the one thing that I think would be a wonderful, wonderful gift to Christians in Pakistan would to get Asia Bibi and her family out of Pakistan. Her health is bad and she won't last very long if the situation continues. I've been given the 5-minute sign, so I'm going to just speed up, even though we started so late, so it's unfair. Such is the climate of hate and anger over charges of blasphemy that two friends of mine, Punjab Governor Salman Taseer, was murdered by his own bodyguard in January after advocating reform of the blasphemy laws and fairer treatment for Asia Bibi. And former Minister Shahbaz Clement Patti was also killed for being a strong voice for the Pakistani Christian community and a strong voice against the blasphemy law. Now, one of the things that I want to, since we seem to be running out of time, but this is sort of important, and I am going to go to this. One of the things that has happened that we look at a similarity between Egypt and Pakistan right now is that last year's Easter attacks in Pakistan, a Jamaatul Erar spokesperson described the motive of the attack as being the desire to convey a message to Pakistani Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif that we have entered Lahore, the Prime Minister's hometown. And ISIS also left a similar attack after attacks against cops, and you know, called them crusaders and outsiders. So why attack, in the case of the Coptic Christians, an ancient indigenous community if the intended target is European crusaders? Not that terrorism against anyone is justifiable. And what is the justification in the case of Pakistan of killing Christian women and children just to deliver a harsh message to the country's prime minister? That the stated objective of terrorist attacks against religious minorities have little to do with the actual targets reflects how Islamist extremists view religious minorities as subhuman. And this is something that's very important. Religious minorities in many of these Muslim majority countries are no longer seen as human on the same level as those of the majority. One measure of the rising tide of intolerance towards non-Muslims in the Muslim world is a declining Christian population in Arab as well as some non-Arab majority Muslim countries. Before 2003, there were 1.2 million Christians in Iraq. Within 10 years, their number halved to about 500,000. The story is not very different in several other countries. Many practicing and ostensibly liberal Muslims tend to argue that extremism does not reflect the true Islam, but they offer no explanation for why antagonism towards minorities continues to expand with only nominal resistance from the majority. Attacks on Christians in Egypt or on Christians, Shias, and Ahmadis in Pakistan do not prompt large-scale protests by Muslims disassociating themselves from such intolerance. The media also does not go beyond a few critical comments, and we do not hear parliaments resounding with impassioned speech about protecting our fellow minority citizens. In such an environment of hostility towards minorities and unwillingness of leaders within the majority to take a stand against bigotry and persecution, what can be done to re-establish protections for embattled religious minorities, especially Christians, who bear the brunt of 80% of the repression? Now, here is what Dan really wanted me to focus on, is what can we all do? First, I propose that we make opposition to religious persecution an important part of U.S. foreign policy, not only in declaratory terms, but also through effective measures. Nations and governments that do not protect their minority citizens, and especially those that actively collude in persecution, must feel they have to pay a price for their repressive and intolerant policies. The United States' decision during the 1980s to emphasize human rights in dealing with the Soviet Union benefited Eastern European and Soviet dissidents. Similar emphasis is needed on protection of religious freedoms, especially in Muslim countries that depend on the United States for economic assistance and military supplies. U.S. diplomats might say that linking aid, trade benefits, and military sale to protection of Christians and other embattled religious minorities amounts to tying their hands. But that argument is often vacuous. Allies and aid recipients that do not respect their own minorities are often also not very reliable partners in the pursuit of American objectives in general. For example, Osama bin Laden living in Pakistan. Second, much of the hate that fuels persecution of Christians and other minorities in Muslim countries comes from school textbooks and mass media. In my book, I have cited many examples of Pakistani textbooks that inculcate in very young minds the notion of people of faiths other than their own as inferior or antagonistic. Curriculum reform targeted separately at each country with a track record for religious persecution and preparing alternate textbooks must be an essential part of any U.S. strategy to combat the prevalent institutionalized intolerance. Third and finally, countries that have institutionalized religious bigotry through laws, like the blasphemy law of Pakistan, must be made to realize how their prejudice laws endanger their participation in contemporary global civilization. This might require a very complex process of making legislators in offending countries and making them realize that communal majoritarianism at home involves costs all around the world. One example is denying visas to travel to the West for all those who advocate or support laws restricting freedom of religion or who may have participated in writing or enacting such laws. Restriction on visas for those inciting violence and religious hatred that already exist must be further strengthened. I will end here, except that I was thinking, and maybe in the Q&A, some kind of special fund needs to be set up for countries like this to pay for legal fees. For example, Asia Bibi had two really terrible lawyers. So a legal fund to help fight discriminatory laws, and I can go into detail with that with anyone who's interested. Thank you very, very much for your time.
Thank you very much indeed for that presentation. And we now have time for questions. So please. Sometimes people are reluctant to ask the first question. So we'll just skip the first question. And let's just go right in into the second.
Here's the second question.
Ah, yes.
Galen Carey with the National Association of Evangelicals. Could you say a little bit about what really is motivates the blasphemy laws and so if we can understand what, obviously they're being misused, but what's the real purpose of them and how could that be countered? Do people really believe that the country is damaged when people blaspheme, or is it something else?
Okay, I'm not a theologian, and that's a very complicated question, but the blasphemy laws go back to the British era, but during the British time, it was very specific that no one of any faith could blaspheme against members of another faith. So basically, they wanted to, in Greater India, make sure that all faiths lived in unity and in harmony. That in Pakistan, that law was changed and made mainly about blaspheming against Allah, the Holy Prophet Muhammad, and the Quran specifically. And that was a crime punishable by death. And as I went through the stages of what has happened in Pakistan, I think I explained that as society, with weak leadership, weak and feckless leadership on all accounts, in every sphere, you ended up seeing that the misuse of this law has had horrendous consequences. But I personally believe the law should not have existed. To amend a bad law is useless. It's a law that kills. It's a law that leads to vigilante action. It is a bad law. So I do not agree on this amending. What does that mean even, really? So it's been as the major tool of persecution of religious minorities, legal tool, which has now also become used by the mobs.
Okay, over there, please. Mustafa?
Oh no, don't ask me a hard question, Mustafa.
I think there are no hard questions for you, but this one. What is the role of Islamic law in Pakistani legislation? I mean, the bishop from Pakistan, for example, mentioned, you know, Christians are not equal in their witnesses, and of course that has roots in Sharia that are problematic and all that. But is that a part of the legislation in Pakistan? There was an Islamization of laws era, I know that, but what is the outcome of that exactly right now?
Well, the outcome of that is no one except a Muslim male can be president of Pakistan. So again, you know, these things have now been part of amendments passed, constitutional amendments. And we have Sharia courts and we have the so-called secular courts. But over time, we've seen even in our Supreme Court that people are giving, the Supreme Court justices are giving judgments based on Quran, Sunnah, Hadith, you know, as opposed to the law. So the infiltration into every aspect of life, the separation of church and state has almost completely disappeared. And that, as I was saying, has been terrible for Muslims who may think differently from this extremist point of view.
Thank you.
So it's a very confusing system, but
it's not officially so Islamic law, Islamic law has impact on the system.
But there are Sharia courts.
There are Sharia courts, yeah.
There are Sharia courts, and I mean, when I served in Parliament, we had a minister for law. We were working on passing a law for the protection of women, harassment of women in the workplace. And the Minister of Law, secular elected minister from my own party, said to me, there's no need for further legislation for women. It's all in the Quran. And I said, you're a lawyer. We are in the Parliament of Pakistan. So when I talk about infiltration, it's very deep.
Mm-hmm. So, thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Nathan Weininger. I'm with the 21st Century Wilberforce Initiative. I was just wondering if the recent Marrakesh Declaration has had any traction in Pakistan, if anyone in Pakistan is using that as a way of, not maybe for specifically religious freedom, but a way of advocating for protection of religious and ethnic minorities.
I mean, I think the Marrakesh Declaration was very important and there was a lot of agreement on a lot of very important and good things. Whether it's had any impact on the ground in Pakistan, I would say not.
Okay, if I may just add, because I do a lot of work in Indonesia, there's also been two declarations out of Indonesia in connection with the world's largest Muslim organization, Nahdlatul Ulama, particularly affirming that the foundation of the polity in a Muslim-majority society is citizenship, not a religious basis. So I would commend those documents as well. There was someone over here.
Nope. Hi, Susanna Pinto with EWTN News Nightly. What has been the reaction in your own political party to your scholarly work and your activism in your party and also generally in Pakistan?
It's interesting in Pakistan. My book won a Peace Prize at the Karachi Literary Festival earlier this year, which meant a great deal to me. It means it resonated, people read it, and that some people I greatly respect, you know, felt that it was an important work. But on the other hand, I do have security problems, but I am no longer also in mainstream politics in Pakistan. I've left political life behind because I have a wider focus now. But did my political party support my book? Did my former colleagues support it? I would say actions speak larger than words. In Sindh province, there was a minority protection bill which was going to pass, and then the party leadership of my former party pulled it and took it back into committee because of pressure from Muslim religious parties. So does that answer your question? Thank you.
Okay. Please, Lauren.
Hi, I'm Lauren Homer with Law and Liberty Trust. I really appreciated your presentation. And I must confess, I feel a little discouraged right now because of what you described, you know, this sort of upward trend that we're dealing with. And so I'm wondering what kinds of interventions might stop it. Aside from the laws, for example, in Pakistan, would a worldwide social media campaign or something be useful, just the same way as, you know, environmental concerns suddenly became something everyone was conscious of? How do we make religious freedom politically correct, I guess is a question.
I think it would take more than, I'm sorry I wasn't uplifting. I actually was giving you a case study for the route that countries, other countries, if you see them sliding in that direction, for example, Turkey or Egypt, that there are mechanisms you need to push your government to put into place now. Don't wait for the worst. So you can take it in a more positive way. Okay, this is the worst, how can we? But I think more importantly is to push for curriculum change, textbook change, remove the hate speech that little children are made to read rather than a social media campaign, I would think. But that's just a personal point of view.
Virginia Ferris with the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops. I think most of us would agree that Pakistan's a very fragile political country right now, and that the military has played a fairly predominant role, both historically and I think currently. So the question I have is, to what extent is the military supportive or not, or does it recognize the importance of religious freedom in the long run? I heard something, I mean, obviously, Samantha Sears' bodyguard was finally executed, and I knew that the military was very much involved with that, and it was done somewhat secretly to presumably avoid protests. So if you can talk about the military's role in light of efforts to advance religious freedom or impede religious freedom.
I don't think an authoritarian state or a military anywhere in the world can be possibly interested in liberal, progressive, and questions of faith. The Pakistani military, I'll come back to Salman Taseer because that's a little vague. The Pakistani military has created these terrorist groups which are blowing up these churches. The you know, a lot of these Taliban groups and groups like Jaish-e-Mohammed or Lashkar-e-Tayyaba, et cetera, what they do is, in the winter months when they're not, you know, doing their geostrategic Pakistani military objectives in Afghanistan or India or Balochistan or wherever regionally, they use these groups. These groups on their off time get into their favorite activity, which is bloodletting. So whether it's Hazara Shias in Quetta, whether it's Christians in Punjab, whether it's Ahmadis anywhere in Pakistan or Shia Muslims. So suddenly when I hear the Pakistani army is doing so much to protect the churches, etc., the point is they have to stop supporting the jihadis. They have to stop supporting the jihadi groups. I really cannot bear this lip service, you know, the lovely colonel in the whatever, you know. I mean, that's not the reality. The reality is get rid of those extremist jihadi groups who are trained to fight and kill and who are armed and who are coming and blowing up your churches. Secondly, the military did not have such a huge role to play in executing Salman Taseer's murderer, Mumtaz Qadri. The civilian government promised the judge, and they did. The moment the judge gave that judgment against Mumtaz Qadri, we had to get him out, him and his entire country out to another place. So I don't know why I'm hearing all this pro-military stuff when all of this stuff, including the blasphemy laws, came from a military dictatorship. So, little surprise. Thank you.
Okay. Farahnaz, thank you very much indeed for your excellent presentation.